I'm sure you've heard the phrase smart contract before. So in this video, we're actually going to dive in and discuss what are they, how do they work, and where you might see them in the crypto sphere. So let's find out.
Hey everyone, Coach K here. Today we're going to talk about what are smart contracts and what were ICOs and what are they going to continue to be. So basically a smart contract works like a normal contract, but it's a coded contract. So it's basically a set of code that has stipulations for both sides. And when those stipulations have all been met, then release of funds will happen. So if we think about something really simple like rent. So let's say I have the key and you're my rental, okay? So what would happen in a smart contract is, on this date, I'm going to give you the key, and that date, the money is going to release. So you'd put like Bitcoin and ETH into the smart contract, right? And then we would both agree to it. And then the key would come on that date or before, and then it would be released to you on that exact date. And then when that happens, the smart contract would be activated and the Bitcoin or Ether would be released to them. So we can do this in a ton of different ways, as you can think. Think of any other contracts that we normally have, and then making them smart contracts. And then it's really hard to get stiffed, for example, if you do any type of business, because they have to lock up that Bitcoin or that Ether or whatever cryptocurrency they put in that smart contract. They have to lock it up. And as long as conditions are met, then they get paid. And if something changes, then you both have to agree that you're going to change that contract. So if a natural disaster happens, whatever, you can change the contract, but both of you have to agree on it. So how it works is if we want to buy or sell a house, here is another example. So make a contract, receive assets, contract distributes assets. So we use the digital currencies and then we settle and clear it. And then basically the land deed will go to the person who bought it and the cryptocurrencies will go to the person who sold it. So smart contracts, pretty cool. The autonomy, so you're the one making the agreement. You don't need a lawyer. You don't need a broker. So you can cut the middleman out. There's trust because your documents are encrypted on a ledger. So it's shared, distributed. Everyone knows that this contract exists. On the blockchain, your documents are duplicated over multiple nodes. So basically multiple computers verify transactions, verify that contract is real, execute that transaction, etc. So it saves you money because you knock out the middleman, obviously, and accuracy. So contracts are not only faster to execute, they're cheaper, and there's no human errors possible when trying to fill out forms because you both read it over and agree on it, and then you can't change that. Whatever you've agreed on is agreed on. So smart contracts can be very simple to very complex. So we can use it as a digital value exchange. We can use them as obligation by a digital content stream. Basic contract, so landlord remotely locks a non-paying tenant out. A multi-party contract where the sender lends the buyer funds to buy a house, and then they pay it over time with interest. Distributed autonomous business unit, so this gets really more confusing. With the unit of corporation issues its own bonds, monitors the payments via a shared ledger. Distributed autonomous organizations, so self-driving trucks, peer-to-peer deliveries, pay local tolls, and basically the cost of it. Distributed autonomous government, so voting on the blockchain, self-governing blockchain services, and then obviously distributed autonomous society, so a group of sellers from different areas establish a self-enforcing trade agreements. It can get really, really complex. We're not there yet. Smart contracts are not that smart right now, but they will get smarter and smarter over time. And so that's something you have to remember, that this is just an infancy. And there have been smart contracts hacked, like the Parity hack. So smart contracts can get hacked, DAOs can get hacked, things can happen still with smart contracts. So they're still developing and making them better and better. And there obviously are services that do it well and they haven't had huge problems, but these are things that over time, when we perfect them, in the later future, we could see that these cut those lawyers and brokers out, so we can actually do more peer-to-peer transactions, make it cheaper for us. So if you're a landlord, like if I was your landlord, I would save on listing fees. I'd save on paying a person to, you know, show you the apartment. I'd save money on paying someone to actually, you know, try to get someone to rent the apartment, because it would be much easier. And then because I'm saving all that money on having to like spend extra, now I can, you know, give you a cheaper price too. So there's another benefit. So ICOs, what are they? They are initial coin offerings. So these are the big boom of 2017, early 2018, where people had all these great ideas that they thought they were great ideas, and people just invested in these great ideas without business plans, really. And they mostly failed, right? Or they were scams because they were unregulated. We have the top 10 ICOs of 2017. We can see them right behind me. Some of them you probably know, some of you don't. And they were massive ICOs like Tezos and EOS as well, as Siren Labs and Quash. There were very big ICOs that happened last year. We also seen a Polkadot with the whole hack. That was not very good. And I want to explain what the difference is. So ICO versus IPO. So ICO is the reason why it was so easy for them to scam people is because there was literally no regulatory oversight. There was no SEC. There was no CTFC. There was no one watching over this. So basically anyone could just like throw their money in, and it could have been a scam and they didn't even know. And there was no one saying, hey, this might be a scam. But with an IPO, they obviously go through a lot of regulatory oversight, like comprehensive, and it's really expensive. And so that also shields you as the investor from getting scammed. And it still happens in the IPO world, but it's a lot harder for someone to do it. So ICOs didn't really have a track record or any real credibility. Some of them did. Some of them came with like really big names on their rosters from big organizations, and they still didn't do that well. Some of them might do well in the future. But yes, track record and credibility, not so much. A lot of non-really very strong people for the economic world. And then IPOs, obviously, it's like Fortune 500 companies, big people that have done really big things in their life, worked for big companies, and know how to actually structure, you know, deals and things like that. But and offerings, these ICOs didn't really know what they were doing for the most part. So utility for ICO was adoption. So basically, like, you know, the more people that use your platform, the more utility you have, that's better. IPOs do it through dividends, so that works well for them. Duration of offerings, so ICOs are like a month, right? And IPOs can last for like, you know, I think 6 months or even a year. Access to offerings, anyone can do it. IPOs, accredited investors. That's something to think about. So who can invest in ICOs? Everybody. Why is that a benefit and a not very good benefit? The good benefit was because if you were investing in an ICO and you knew it was good and you did really good research and you didn't just listen to shills, you probably could have made a huge amount of money, and you probably did. But the most average investor would just listen to someone on YouTube say like, this is a great investment, throw all your money in. And there was a ton of them that hit great and some of them just bombed, right? And so that was really hard for a lot of people, but that was because unregulated and there was a lot of scams. So you have to take all that stuff into consideration. Now, in the real world, these guys get to invest in big companies. They're accredited investors. They're millionaires. They can afford to lose $25,000 if they invest in that. Most people can barely afford to lose $1,000 in an investment. So yeah, that's basically the problem with IPOs, is not everyone could invest. So ICOs gave everyone the opportunity to make money, and a lot of people did do really well with some of the ICOs that they invested in. So the point is that ICOs were not all bad, and some of them will do very well, like Brave. You know, their browser was almost like Google Chrome. So the more adoption from some of the really good projects will increase the amount of people using them. And I just want to look at some of the scams. You know, BitConnect this problem, and Confido are probably the two that you guys remember. Maybe PlexCoin you've heard of, but most of these other ones, I mean, Ponzi coin, that's kind of speaks for itself. But most of these projects, you know, scammed a lot of people. ICOs are not all scams. 80% of them were. What we're seeing now is more higher level ICOs coming out that are much better quality. So over time, we're going to see that improve. Just like anything else in technology, when it first starts, everyone goes, explodes, you know, has every idea they think of. And then as people understand the technology over time, we'll see them adapt and use AI and other things involved with the blockchain and with crypto that we can use our crypto for and benefit from it. And so those are things that we have to look forward to. And so I'm not saying ICOs are dead at all. I think STOs, which are security token offerings, I'll talk about those in another video, will come and offer equity, which is cool. And yeah, we'll see how everything goes. But yeah, basically a smart contract is a contract that's not actually smart nor a contract legally yet, but in the future it might be. And it does a lot of the things that we need it to do. We could even use it as an escrow for a deal where, you know, once you get all the paperwork signed, the money gets released from the escrow as like a smart contract. So there's cool things that we'll be able to use it for, even with marriages and other things like that. We'll be able to make contracts for those things as well. And so it's a really bright future is what I'm trying to say. And do they have problems? Sure. But will they get better and resolve them and make, you know, leaps forward? Absolutely. So that's what we have to look forward to in this. So go to that little video quiz that we got at the end, and I'll see you guys later. Fat kiddo, fat kiddo, fat kiddo, huge fat.